And chapter 25, we're going to learn something together. We're going to tell you something. I'm going to share something the Lord has told me as a matter of introduction. Many of you are looking forward to me as a preacher according to the world. You have an introduction, the body, and a conclusion. All right. Here is an introduction, and the introduction is kingdom principles regarding your finances. Amen. Kingdom principles regarding your finances. Now, you must remember that God is really interested in everything that you do. He is also interested in your situations. As an introduction, I learned recently that no colleges, even in the United States of America, ever teach about finances. Sadly, young people come to know about finances at the age of 50. At that time, they suddenly realize, my God, I should have started at the age of 20 so that I could have retired by the time I'm 50. I could have had all my money saved up either in stocks or in some real estate or some holdings, and I could have had a good time. I didn't have to go to this 10 to 6 routine or late 9 to 11, and that's a sad story all over even the United States of America, the richest country in the whole world, if I'm made to understand, or definitely a country that stands by the Judeo-Christian principles. We all know that this is a very prosperous country. Hallelujah. Praise God. But what I'm surprised, and what many people today are surprised, is they don't have a course to teach about finances. It's very important. So let us start from church. Hallelujah. Praise God. Don't tell yourself, this guy is up to something. He's finally going to tell us, give money for the building. That's not the idea. Hallelujah. We are praying for the building. The building has come. Money will come. We serve a mighty God. And you should be happy that none of us are in the habit of going and asking people, Betsy, I heard you're making a million. Give for your church. She will never hear Shijongal saying that. But she will hear Jesus saying that at some time. Hallelujah. We are not beggars. We are princes. Our king is a rich king. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. By the way, people already go around and tell people, you know, that church is a very rich church. I recently came to know about it. Are you happy? Go tell somebody, this is a rich church. We don't have to beg or borrow or steal. Hallelujah. We don't have to beg or borrow or steal. Amen. All right, let's go to the scriptures. 25 verse 14. Here we go. For the kingdom of heaven is as a man traveling into a far country, who called his own servants and delivered unto them his goods. And unto one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, and to another 1, to every man according to his several ability, and straightway took his journey. Then he that had received the 5 talents went and traded with the same, and made them other 5 talents. Likewise, he that had received 2, he also gained other 2. But he that had received 1 went, digged in the earth, and hid his master's or Lord's money. After a long time, the Lord of those servants comes and reckons with them. And so he that had received 5 talents came and brought other 5 talents, saying, Lord, you delivered unto me 5 talents. Behold, I have gained beside them 5 talents more. His Lord said unto him, well done, you good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over a few things. I will make thee ruler over many things. Enter you into the joy of the Lord. He also that had received 2 talents came and said, Lord, you delivered unto me 2 talents. Behold, I have gained 2 other talents besides them. His Lord said to him, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over a few things. I will make you ruler over many things. Enter into the joy of the Lord. Then when he which had received the 1 talent came and said, Lord, I knew that you are a hard man, reaping where you did not sow, gathering where you had not strawed. That's my King James version. And I was afraid, and went and hid your talent in the earth. Behold, there thou hast, that is thine. His Lord answered and said unto him, you wicked and slothful servant, you know that I reap where I sowed not, and gather where I have not strawed. You should have therefore put my money to the exchangers, and then at my coming I should have received mine own with usury. Verse 26. Take therefore the talent from him and give it unto him which has 10 talents. For to everyone that has, church, I want you to focus on this. This could be probably something I pray God will speak to you. To everyone that has shall be given, and he shall have abundance. But from him that has not shall be taken away even that which he has. Let me start there. Have you heard this phrase, the rich continues to become rich and the poor continues to become poor? And do you know that a lot of people take this as the slogan for their political agenda? Well, the good news or the absolute is this will not change. Any government that comes, this is not going to change. I know you're angry, especially the younger millennials and would-be millennials are upset with me. Those who are rich will continue to be rich. That's what is, why are you looking at me like that? I didn't write it. This scripture was written so many years ago, even from the foundations of the world, according to my understanding. And come on, read with me. Some of you don't believe the Bible. I just realized. Read it. Come on, church. To everyone that has shall be given. And he shall have what? Abundance. But from him that has not shall be taken away even that which he... Who said this? Only Pastor George knows the truth. Who said this? So what does it mean? Those who have, they will receive more. How many of you have? We are going to break this poverty mentality today in Jesus' name. You have? How many of you have? Come on, church. Some of you are not sure, you know. Some of you are not lifting your hands because, Pastor, I have two babies. Does it mean something? I'm starting off there. This is a principle of God. Church, we must acknowledge and agree with our heavenly Abba that his principles are always right. He will never make a mistake. God will not make a mistake. God cannot make a mistake. He is God. Everything concerning us, even from the foundations of the world, he has set everything correctly. Therefore, he cannot make a mistake. Now, let me take you to 14. The first thing I told you, whoever is rich will continue to become rich. And I want to tell you one more thing before I move forward. May the Lord strengthen me and anoint my words. Poverty is not God's idea. Poverty is a curse. Lack is a curse. Amen. No, it's not God's plan for you. It's not. You know, there are many, many friends. I'm not being critical. God help me. A lot of people come to the United States and they begin to behave as though, why did you come to the United States? For a better life. Come on. No, Pastor, I came to plant the church of God. Come on, give me a break. You can plant a church anywhere in the world. I came for the gospel of Jesus Christ. Come on. Come on. Why did you come to the United States, church? I'm talking to you. For a better life. The American dream. Let's accept it. My question is, why did this dream, why did this American dream become so popular all over the world? I never heard of an Indian dream. Never heard of a Pakistan dream. Never heard of an Ireland dream. I did not even hear of an England dream. But the American dream. Shall I tell you why? Because here, the foundations were laid by men and women who came for religious freedom. Not to do what you want. That is not freedom. And God taught them the foundations and the principles of becoming wealthy. So that we can help the poor. If I don't have money, how can I go and help somebody else? Oh, you're not getting it. I have no intention to being a parasite all the days of my life. Are you? Do you have an intention? We are called in the kingdom of God to become assets. Take somebody's hand and say, I've been called into the kingdom to become an asset. Say, I am an asset in the kingdom of God. I am an asset in the kingdom of God. Hallelujah. Praise God. So God is going to make you fruitful assets. Fruitful assets so that you will have plenty to enjoy and to give. So today we need to get out of this poverty mentality and start saying, I have, instead of saying, nothing. No, I don't have anything. People have thousands of dollars stashed away in their bank account. I don't have anything. What they don't realize is when they say that, God is looking, all right, you don't have anything? You don't acknowledge what I give it to you? Give it to Pastor Shiju. Somebody said hallelujah. Thank you. You just said hallelujah to what I said. Be careful when you say amen or hallelujah. Hallelujah. With your mouth, bless the Lord who has given you. Amen. All right, we'll continue the scriptures. There is this man. I'm going to first of all look at the character of this master. Great guy, huh? For the kingdom of heaven is as a man traveling into a far country. He has the ability to travel whenever he wants. Isn't that a good thing? Look at him. Who called his own servants. He was not borrowing somebody else's servant. He called his own. That is a part of his influence. He had his own servants in the home and gave them his goods. Verse 15, I'm going to talk about this man. He was able to travel far. He had his own servants and he handed over the goods to him. You know what it means? He was absolutely in control of what he had. Remember this. He was absolutely in control. He knew. For example, if I were to ask you, do you know how much money you have in your purse now? Don't worry, I won't ask you. I won't pinch it. But how many of you really know how many dollars you have? How many of you really know to the penny that you have in the bank? Only a banker in the church knows. Nobody else knows. I'm asking you. How many of you really know how much you have? $15,234.22 next year. You don't know, but look at this man. He knows what he has. That is why he is able to divide equally or divide for his servants. And look at his sharp eye. Look at this. Verse 15 says, to every man according to his several ability. The King James Version is a good thing for you to read. It has so many words and verses translated from the original. And also the King James Version was birthed after a lot of fasting, prayer and torture. It's history which you don't know. That is why I love the King James Version. Here we go. This man was giving to each servant according to several ability. The word several means each servant he knew the capacity of. He knew the guy who had a 5 talent would be able to multiply. He was watching the servants. Another good character of this master. He was watching the servant. How many of you are in a position in your company or in a position in your workplace where God has given you probably 3 or 4 people? This is expected of you. Watch them. Watch them. All right. And to every man according to his several ability, and straight away took his journey. Point number 4 about this wealthy man, he handed over everything to different people straight away. That means without any hesitation, without looking back, without dilly-dallying, without worrying, he has finished his work, he's completed, and he moves off. Are you getting a picture there? What a smart man is he, right? He's completed everything. He planned everything ahead. He had his own servants. He had his own money. He planned for A, B, and C. A can have 5, B can have 2, and C can have 1. All right, guys, come together. I am deciding how much you should have. You take 5, you take 2, you take 1. I am ready to go. I've closed it. It is completed. Now, go and make money. Do whatever you think is right according to what I have given. Look, do you see the character of that man? Perfect, well-planned, well-conditioned. Everything is according to what he plans. How many of you like a life like this? Amen. Hallelujah. Now let's look at this man again. Verse 19. After a long time, the Lord of those servants come back. What is he now? Yes, come back. But what is he now? What is the position? He is the Lord. You know what it tells me about this man? Even in his absence, nobody dared to lift their ugly head of the flesh. He was away in the country. No WhatsApp, no telephone, no email, no spies anywhere. What does that tell you about this man? He kept everybody according to their plan and got them busy. There was no rebellion, no mutiny, nothing. Are you getting a picture? You're not getting a picture. I'm talking about the characteristics of a man who the Bible shows as a wealthy man. I'm telling you how this man, the character of this man is. Verse 19, after a long time, maybe 3 years, 4 years, the Lord of those servants come back. That means in his absence, even after 2-3 years, nobody assumed to be the next Lord. You're getting that, no? Nobody said, all right, this guy is not to be seen. He has been away for 3-4 years. Who knows, probably he died. All right, we will become the next master. You don't see that happening here, church. You know why? Because I believe, along with this man, they also feared God. There is a beautiful verse in the Bible. Honor comes not from the east or the west. Honor comes from God. Remember that. Amen. After a long time, the Lord of those servants comes and reckons with them. All right. It's a matter of accountability. What does that tell you about this man? Even after giving his money to somebody, he still wanted to know what had happened to his money. Amen. Now, a lot of people use that in the wrong way. After they put it in the church, not in this church, hopefully. Pastor, is he buying the latest Lexus? That is with my money. Wrong attitude. But the rest of the things you should be concerned about. You know why a lot of churches are not blessed? Because even after giving an offering, people's heart and mind are still in the offering. And the way they express it is by looking at the pastor, looking at how the committee members are running around, looking at the church building, and that is a wrong thing to have. Tell somebody, leave things at the offertory and give it to God. Don't worry about it. Tell somebody like that. Hallelujah. Give my money to the offertory. I am giving it unto the Lord. And the Lord will return it to me. Hallelujah. Praise God. But apart from giving to the Lord, every penny that goes out of this man, he knew. Even after 3-4 years, when he comes back, he has an Evernote. For some people, Evernote is a never note. He had an Evernote and he looked down at his Evernote and said, all right, I gave to A5. Let me talk to A. I talked to B. I have 2. And I talked to C. He has 1. Look at the smartness of this man. He is accountable to himself. Tell somebody, accountable to himself. Hallelujah. And now he goes. So he that had received 5 talents came. He's the first one who came. He came and brought other 5 talents, saying, Lord, you gave me 5. Behold, I've gained besides them 5 talents more. What was he busy doing all these years? He was busy investing that 5. Praying with that 5, giving a tithe to the Lord, working on it. We're going to get into that. The Lord said, all right, well done, you good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over a few things. I will make you ruler over many things. Enter into the joy of the Lord. A few things. You have been faithful in a few things. You know how much this few things is? 1 talent mentioned here is about 95 kilograms of pure gold according to Israel measurement. The measurement of Israel, 1 talent is about 95 kilograms of pure gold. Now imagine 5 talents, 95 into 5, that will be 900, 95 into 5 would be 450 plus 25, 475 kilograms of gold. How many of you want that? You don't want it? Give it to me. Hallelujah. He also had received 2 talents. It was so valuable. But this man says, you have been faithful in a few things. For me, how much is the 475 kilograms of gold is? But you were given 475 kilograms of gold. All right, do one thing. I will make you a ruler. I like this man. I'm talking about this man's character. He observes people. He sees how good they are. And then he promotes them. Oh, somebody said hallelujah. If you are faithful in what God has given you, you don't have to wait for the Reverend Father Nainan Thomas to come and lift you up. God will lift you up. Amen. You see the master here. Put Jesus in this place. Are you faithful in prophesying? Are you faithful in leading worship? Are you faithful? Yes, Darren, I know. Faithful behind the mic. Faithful behind the camera. Faithful in the pulpit. Faithful in giving. The little that you have. Even if you're giving $1, you don't have to wait for anybody to lift you up. We have a great master who will honor you. Hallelujah. Look at that man. Well done, you good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over a few things. I will make you ruler over many things. Enter into the joy. Along with promotion comes joy. Say promotion with joy. Hallelujah. I don't know if I should say this, but I mean it as a joke. There was a person in the country where I come from, you know, just beginning to learn English. So she went to the hospital and the doctor said something. So she came out and she said, I don't know what is happening, but somebody has got cancer with abortion. I said, don't say, you don't even know what you're talking about. You hear some words, some shen, all that. People of God, we have joy with promotion. Say joy with promotion and total healing. Somebody said joy with promotion, a promotion with joy. Take somebody's hand and say joy with promotion. Hallelujah. Whatever situation you are going through right now, let me tell you prophetically, take it from your church, take it from the pulpit of your church, which belongs to Jesus. Whatever you're going through, there is promotion with joy. And Joseph was lifted up. Can you imagine Joseph going to stand before the Pharaoh? Kashta nashta mere vanna. That was not Joseph. Overnight, the Pharaoh called Joseph. Joseph, come here. I'm going to put this on you. You are now. And how do you think Joseph took it? Ishu tera naam sabse uncha hai. Promotion with joy. And can I say this? Is coming your way. Praise God. Hallelujah. Church, I want you to know this. I want you to believe this. God is going to bless you as a body. You will see it visibly. Hallelujah. You will see it. He blesses his body together. Promotion with joy. How many of you want a promotion with joy? Hallelujah. Have you been faithful in the little God has given you? If you have not been, today is the day to tell him, Lord, I have not been faithful in certain areas, but give me one more chance. Our God is a God of a second chance. Remember this. Our God is a God of a second chance. Look at verse 21. Again, the character of the Lord. He said unto him, well done, you good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over a few things. I will make thee ruler over many things. Enter into joy of the Lord. You know what that tells me about this master and therefore the Lord Jesus Christ? There is no difference of measurement for the Lord. To the one who brought in 10, he says the same thing. To the one who brought in 4, he says the same thing. Then where is the difference? The difference is in the person's ability to make money. Remember, God is a righteous judge and a righteous rewarder. If you have been asked to been given 5, be faithful in 5. If you have been given 1, be faithful in 1. Because the reward is hearing this, well done, my good and faithful servant. Hallelujah. Well done. Maybe you got 1 talent. It's like singing. Develop it for the glory of God. Maybe you got a talent. How many of you think you have a talent to make money? Because that is where we are coming to. I'm going through the scriptures. Nobody has a talent to make money in this church. You have a talent to make money? Let me see your hands. My God. That is why Pastor George tells me, Pastor, our church is running by faith. We always get what we want, right, Pastor? All our needs are met with. And we have 3 people who know how to make money. We'll come to that. Okay, we got the right subject. Hallelujah. Praise God. Okay, so we talked about the master and his character. He has the same measure, but it is the people and their ability to do the things that matters. You will be given an apostleship with 5-fold gifts. If God sees that you're willing to, if you're ready to. Apostle Paul was willing to. He said, I throw my entire life at the master. Here, Lord, take it. Amen. You know what all God did through Paul? He planted churches. He raised the dead, healed the sick, cast the demon, made him to write scriptures. You know the price he paid for that? His entire life. Now you know why some churches flourish and some churches don't? Your commitment. You know why some lives flourish and some lives don't? Because they commit. Our commitment to what God has given to us will make the difference. Let me tell you, God has given a vineyard to everybody. Church, before we move on from there, Be faithful in what you have. And I want to tell you from today, never say that you don't have. Because with your mouth, you're creating lack. And evil spirits would love to work on negative words. Really? The more you say you have nothing, your eyes will begin to become blind to see what God has given to you. But people of God, when you say, I have, thank God. I am part of the American dream. Thank God. I have something to look forward to. Thank God. I have something. Whenever I come to church on a Sunday morning, I look at the number of cars and I say, Lord, I thank you for the increase. Do you do that? I want you to do that. Thank you for the multiplication. Thank you. And then I say prophetically, thank you for the thousands that are coming. A thank you will make a big difference. It comes to my heart again and again to tell you about my parents. Not anything private, but some tell you. My mother and my dad, they told me a testimony many, many years ago. When a point, they came to a zero point in their life. And they did not have a church like this at that time to go. And how God prospered them from that part. And one of the things I've seen and I appreciate in my parents, I have to tell you, and I hope my children will see that and appreciate in me. I have never heard my dad or mom complaining or grumbling even once. Never a complaint. Hallelujah. Never. I want to appreciate my parents. If they don't mind, they can both stand up where they are. Not because they are my parents. No, don't get me wrong. I have first-hand testimony to tell you. Do you agree with me, my sister? In the flesh? Okay. I want to appreciate you, my dad and my mom. Never ever I have ever heard a word of complaint. They have been through thick and thin. Today, they are wealthy. They have their children just half a mile on either side, like Brother Vinu said on the cross. One thief on the right and one on the left. So I asked him, which are you? He said, I'm the right thief. That is when he looks from that side. When I look on my that side, Sheila and he are the thieves. And we are, Reena and I are right. But I thank God for these wonderful people. This is one thing I picked up from them. Never ever a word of grumbling or lack. They are blessed. And they have three houses now. They have freedom to go into their children's house. I was surprised to hear the routine of my mom. Her heart's greatest desire was that towards the end of her life, she would have something in the bank, not depending on anybody. And she will always have time to praise the Lord. From Monday through Saturday, she is busy in either a son's house or a daughter's house, prayer meeting. She is at peace, both my parents. They are assured of their eternal future, and they see their children thriving. What more do you want? Thank you. God bless you, Achin and Kochama. We are privileged that you are part of this church. I mean it from my heart. Hallelujah. People of God, I know you're all like that. Take somebody's hand and say, I'm eternally grateful to Jesus. I'm grateful to Jesus for what I have. I'm grateful to Jesus for what I have. Tell somebody, I have a pastor. I'm grateful. Say that for your good. We have some... I'm grateful to these two people, not because they are very gifted. I don't know. I pray gifts will come. But they are both faithful to the Lord. The condition in this church to become a pastor is, number one, they should be faithful to God. And then they should be faithful to the church and the ministry. Pastor George handles the finances. Don't try to rob him. But we have an understanding I want you to know very clearly. The smallest money check that is being written there, he's answerable to God. I tell him, anything that I ask, you ask God first. Am I right? I am grateful for people like that. If I decided to rob you tomorrow and run away, he said, no way, Pastor, hold on. I like people like that. Not those who are man pleasers, but those who love the Lord. That is how the church is. Be grateful for what you have. Hallelujah. Praise God. So these are some of the things that you see is the quality and the character of this wealthy man. Amen. Now let me take you to this point. The Bible tells you in the book of Deuteronomy. Let's go there now. Deuteronomy chapter 18. Let us change our mentality towards money. Deuteronomy. Our mentality towards money must change. We must stop thinking, having poverty mindsets and think rich and have a rich attitude or a wealthy attitude. I'll give you that verse in a minute. 8:18. This is an old covenant promise. Deuteronomy 8:18. This is an old covenant promise. It is fulfilled in Christ Jesus. When it comes to the New Testament, you will see the difference, which I'll tell you in a minute. May the Lord help me and strengthen my memory. But you shall remember the Lord your God, for it is He that gives you power to get wealth, that He may establish His covenant, which He swore unto your fathers. Deuteronomy 8:18. Church, if you like to, you can read it with me again. Let's read it. Come on. But you shall remember the Lord your God, for it is He that gives you power to get wealth, that He may establish His covenant, which He swore to your fathers, as it is this day. This is a covenant promise which God gave to His people in the old covenant. Hallelujah. Praise God. What were the riches during the time of Abraham? The riches during the time of Abraham was sheep, servants, all these things. Hallelujah. In our time, what is the wealth? That's what we are coming to. Everything, yes, everything is in Him complete. Hallelujah. Now the wealth given to Abraham did not come from Abraham. It came by an anointment. Tell me, an anointment. The wealth for Isaac did not come from himself. It came from an anointment. Supernatural anointment was given to Isaac. How many of you remember, saints? The same year Isaac sowed, he got 100-fold. The same year. Show me one plantation where they will tell you, you know, sow today, reap tomorrow. Nowhere in the world. It's supernatural. It is supernatural. Sowing, reaping, the same year. It is supernatural. That comes from an anointment. Say anointment. Anointment. So what is really God giving you? It is the anointing that is important. Yeah, somebody come and tell me, Pastor, you know what? I want to become rich. I said, good idea. But before you want to become rich, I want to ask you, why do you want to become rich? Because the motivation is very important. Why? Why do you want to become rich? You know, I have a score to settle with the Trump Foundation. You know, I said, wrong. Don't do it. You know, I want to buy all those Trump links and golf links. Relax. You don't have to become rich for that. Hallelujah. I want to show some people who I am. Wrong motivation. Pastor, you don't know. When I was in Kerala, I was living so bad. When I come to America, I want people in Kerala to know how rich I am. Very bad thing to do. Hallelujah. But the right motivation, because God wants me to become rich. Oh, come on. Come on, come on, come on. You're not getting this, people. God wants to make you wealthy in His way. That's a message. And for that, He says, take an anointing from Me. You can't do it by yourself. You need to be anointed. First of all, you need to be cleansed in your mind. What is the motivation for you to become rich? I want to become rich because God wants me to become rich. And if God wants me to become rich, there is a reason for that. He wants me to be a blessing to the nations. People of God, let me ask you this. If I don't have the wealth of God's word in me, how can I preach the word of God to you? If I don't have the wealth of God's grace, how can I be compassionate to somebody else? If I don't have the gift of healing, how can I preach healing to somebody else? The wealth of God is contained in His anointment. That's the difference between the rich of the world and the rich of the kingdom of God. Hallelujah. So get an anointing. Are you getting something? You are praying for a rise in your increase in your job. You're looking for another job. You're praying that your stock market things will continue to go on. You're praying that your real estate business will soar. Here is the answer for that. Cleanse your motivation and ask the Lord for an anointment. Somebody said hallelujah to that. Hallelujah. Praise God. That is the wealth of God. And when He gives you that anointment, number one, you will be rich in your spirit. You will never have a poverty mindset. You will never say, you know, I don't have anything. Even when you may be living in a castle, you know, I don't have anything. In the anointing, you will say, I am living in a hut, but I have just one cloth to wear, but I have. I've told you this. I don't know how you took it. I don't care how you take it or anybody takes it. Not a single cloth of mine was purchased with my money, maybe one or two shirts. When I speak like this, my wife goes back and tells me, "Sicha, one shirt you bought with your money." I said, "All right, honey." From the day I started my ministry, God knows, not only in the United States of America, because I went for the gospel of Jesus Christ, He has taken care of everything. This is all purchased. In fact, I have a cloth committee in this church. You will not know who it is. That person makes it a point to somehow. That person comes and says, "Pastor, I see, you know, pastors outside wearing a red, what is that? Not a churidar, I don't wear a churidar, but a red, what do you call this? Sweater. I want my pastor to have the best sweater." I said, "Thank you." Do you call that wealth or not? Have the wealth of Christ in you. That is why sometimes when pastors come here to the church, ask people, asking money, I said, "We don't want that here. We don't want our people to be beggars. We want people to be asking God. God is my witness. May God help me." I made once the mistake of asking a person. Once. For our church. Not for our personal thing. Once. Far away. I said, "You know what? It is because that person told me, you know, Pastor, you know, we can help you out." And as of, I didn't ask the Lord. The mistake I did. I went and asked him, "You know what? Our church is going to be built." He would never take the phone after that. I'm telling you firsthand. You know why I was ashamed or I was insulted? Because that's what the Lord was saying. "Why don't you look at my face? When did you stop looking at my face?" Hallelujah. Apart from that, for nothing of myself, I've never asked people. But God has provided. Do you see me having a car here, a driver car? Let me tell you, I have no right to drive a car like that, except that I've driven for years in India. You know, that is a gift to me. You know, somebody wrote me a check years ago, just like that, because of my Jesus. You think it's a joke? I don't want to tell you who that person is. My God is a wealthy God. Have Christ in you. The wealth is Christ, and He gives you the anointment. Sometimes people ask, "Pastor, why on earth do you have this?" You know, Revival Church is the only church in America which we know, Monday evening prayer meeting, phone line meeting, Wednesday morning and evening, now Friday also morning and evening, Saturday again special there, Sunday. Are you crazy? I said, "Who, me? I'm not crazy. You are crazy." You know why? Every minute I spend with the Word of God, every minute I spend in worshiping my God, is an investment into the kingdom. If Shiju Pastor ever calls anybody to come for the meeting, it is to know, not to show people how many number of people we have. It is to make you to be part of the anointing of the church, making it free for you, so that you can dig deep and receive deep riches of truth, which will make you wealthy in the spirit and make you wealthy outside. Do I hear an amen for that? Praise God. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Amen. Take the anointing. The anointing makes a difference. Can we have an anointing for that? Yes, all the anointment required is in the name of Jesus. Revival Church, I want you to know, not only for holiness and purity, not only for running away from the world, we also need an anointing to manage daily affairs. I'm going to the next point in anointing. You have an anointing to make money. You also need an anointing to keep money. Because the Bible says, a fool and his riches are soon parted. A fool and his wealth is soon parted. That means a fool can have a lot of money. For example, this is a season, tax season. And I say, "Lord, of foolish people are getting money." But few people keep it. So I got, not about me, you know. I might have to pay tax this year, praise God. Hallelujah. Yeah, because you're a pastor, it's a wealthy guy. Yeah? You don't have the kind of wealth I have. Praise God. But imagine, you get a sudden inrush of money, you know. $7,000, $8,000, $2,000, $5,000. What do you do with that? "Pastor, I'm not giving to the church." If that is your plan, no, I didn't ask you to give it to the church. "No, I'm not giving to anybody in Ethiopia or Africa or America." No, you don't have to. What do you plan to do with it? Pastor, I'm putting it in my savings bank. Every week I switch on the password. 5,000, 10,000. Did you know that if you save money without utilizing it, you are losing a percentage of that money in value? I am going to teach you to save money. Very important, especially to the next generation. But did you know, saving without investment, when the king comes back, he's going to tell you, I gave you $100,000. What did you do with it? Lord, I put it in the savings bank. God said, really? What is the value of that $100,000 now? Lord, it is about $94,000 now. You, not a good servant. You lost $6,000 of mine. What did you do with that saving? You have been, if you were saving your money in the last 10 years, if you have been working hard, let us take the lease. We would have had $5,000 with you. What do you plan to do with it? Pastor, this is not the message we came for. This is a Lord's Day. We are talking about holiness and purity, and purity and holiness. That is all you will hear all the days of your life. I want to tell you one thing. Exactly like purity and holiness, God is interested in accountability and stewardship. Jesus did not come for holy people alone. He came for his bride. And his bride is holy, pure, separated from the world, absolutely. And his bride is free from any charge that can come from heaven. How did you utilize the money I have? We heard the characteristics of the great master. Now let me come back to the next part in that thing. Look at the way the poverty mentality of this guy who finally lost out. Look at his mentality. Let's learn something from there. Let me take you back to the book of Matthew. Matthew 25:24. Then he which had received the one talent came and said, listen to this, even before the master says something, unlike the other two before him, he comes and says to the master, what is it? Lord, I knew you. Lord, I know you. You are a hard man, reaping where you have not sown, gathering where you have not strawed. And I was, what was his mentality? He was watching his boss with the wrong mindset. Look at this attitude. Look at this character of the boss. Come on, read it with me. Reaping where you have not sown, gathering where you have not. Whose character is that really? Did you know? Our Almighty Father is like that. That is why he gave you a promise in me. You will drink from wells which you have not dug. For you, he will take from where you have not sown. Ningal vedakkathathu ninnu koyyum. You will drink from water, wells which you have not dug. Because that is the character of your Heavenly Father. Now, but look at this guy. He was with the master. God is making a point here. He was with the master, but his heart was not with the master. If his heart was with the master, he would have really picked up that quality and applied it in his own life. My God, I am an apprentice. I am walking with my master. This master pulls from where he has no say, and he begins to pull out what he has not sown. I can do the same thing. Instead of duplicating or reduplicating his master's vision, he used that to shut himself down. People of God, when you hear that your Heavenly Father can do things which is not according to the normal common human standards, remember, he's calling you to do that. Do I hear an amen? If you are children of the true Father, if you are really born again, you have the Spirit of God and the Word of God inside you. Unfortunately for this man, his heart was far away. I'm reminded of Judas. You know the problem with Judas? Just like all the other disciples, he was also walking with Jesus. Every day, he would come for every church meeting. He would say, praise the Lord. You think Judas will not say, praise the Lord, hallelujah? He would say, but his heart was never with God. When a time of crisis came, he fell. But the others, their heart was with God. And it is easy for them to magnify the Lord has given. Praise God. The major thing that has come to you today, which we'll transfer you today, go and be anointed to make wealth. Hallelujah. Praise God. I want to quickly shoot up something for the upcoming generations, the millennials. What do you call the next? Are you the so-called millennials? Hallelujah. Listen to me, all of you under the age of 40, that includes me too. Those who want to be under the age of 40, you can listen to me. Start praying today. God will begin to give you incomes even now. Even now. It is not a bad thing to work. I know we all are children of great Maharajas and, you know, great Brahmin community and all that wonderful. But I just want you to know, those of you who come from Kerala, the community that is most under poverty today is the old Kerala Brahmin community. They had thousands and thousands and thousands of acres and acres of land at one time. Today, many of them do not have even a single tile over their floor. You know why? Because they took all these things for granted. Some of you claim, some of us claim that our forefathers, okay, let it be anything, who cares? Children, are you listening to me? Let me tell you the dream. Put this target. Don't work for it. Put this target. Lord, I want to be financially free at such and such an age. Not above, Lord, by the time I'm 70, you know, cool it. Lord, I want to be financially free. Is it possible? It is possible in a country like America. You can. Because this country was planted by the word of God. God doesn't desire you to toil and make, be focused on making money all the days of your life. And then finally, before you die, you get into pension and a pension scheme and your children begin to enjoy. Hello. Can you take somebody's hand and say, let the children work for themselves? Can you be bold enough to say that? Teach them to stand at a young age. Dennis, you know, some time ago, he was translating for a prophetess who came from India, Sister Renise and Brother Cherians. She suddenly turned around and said, I want to remind you of that prophecy. You remember that prophecy? She said, I know you don't remember. She looked at Dennis and said, son, you're going to buy a house. It's so big. You remember that? Yeah, go do it. That is God's prophecy.
Amen, amen, yes.
Dennis, you won't have any fight with me. No competition. I love you. You're my son. Why would such prophecies come? Please understand this. The Lord wants to give you an anointment. You have been placed in a country where our children should be set free. Not morally. Don't get me wrong. Not spiritually, they are under you. But even when they are under you, they are submissive to you. They are accountable to you. Teach them the principles of sowing. If encourage them to find a work. That is the beauty of this country, which God has planted. Go work. I heard somebody in the West, you know, in America, of course, by the age you are 16 or 17. Now don't get the wrong messages from me. Take it right. By the time 16 or 17, parents just ask the children either to leave, they are supposed to find their own job. And I know self-made multimillionaires starting making money by raking leaves. Miria and Leah Achu have a friend who they still live opposite my parents' house right here on Wingtip. And I was surprised last winter, her brother suddenly appeared at my door. I said, what is it? Can I do the snow? I said, yeah, you can do the snow. You know, I was a little tired. How much? He looked around quickly. He was in high school. 13, 14, he looked at all around. $25, uncle. He didn't call me uncle, that is just to relate to them. But, you know, my old Kerala Nasrani. That attitude, son, do it, I'll give you 5 more. But the anointing in me said, hold on. He's asking 25. I said, son, I'll let you know. I wanted him to value that money. He did it eventually. You know what I was doing? If I went there and, Moni, oh, you're mole. So pavam, yeah. You're making all this snow for me. Have some cup of coffee and tea. You know what the children will think? I don't want to use the word here. Teaching people value. Don't bring your heart. Bring the anointing of Jesus. Nobody wants our sympathy. Nobody wants our sympathy. When you are sympathized and try to feed people with your sympathy, you know what you get? You get a group of sympathetic people. They're always sympathetic. They're always in need. They always depend psychologically on their dad and mom all the time. I sometimes wonder what will happen if their parents suddenly are called by the Lord. They will be psychologically depleted. Let us raise up a generation who can sow into their life the principles of God. Do I hear an amen? Hallelujah. Let this poverty mentality break. We are not beggars. We are children of the Most High. He has provided through His anointing. It's through His anointment. Are you following me? He hasn't given you an anointment. That is why Paul cried out and said, the riches of His glory. Malayalam we say, Mahatvadhanam. What is that Mahatvadhanam? It comes from heaven. And that can attract peace. That can attract glory. That can attract everything good. Also that will attract what you need in this world. Because the book of Peter says, He has given to us all things. That is, for all that you need, that He has already given to you. And once you have it, you begin to invest into the kingdom. And you become rich unto God. I want to put this picture across to you. One day when we go back to Jesus, what are you going to give back to Jesus? Are you going to tell Him, Lord, thank you, I finally got there, you know. At least I got there. The church, they were not good people, Lord. But I only was a good person, you know. I finally came, hallelujah. And God is likely to ask, okay, I gave you an anointment, what do you do with this? Oh, you gave me an anointing? Yeah, what did you do with this? I gave you money, what did you do with this? I gave you the ability to sing, what did you do with this? Pastor didn't promote me, so I was waiting for pastor to promote me. I am your pastor, he will tell you that day. I am your pastor. You want an opportunity? Ask me. You want money? Ask me. You want to invest? Ask me. You want an opportunity to bring out a record of yourself? Ask me. You want a place to preach? Ask me, says the Lord. I am the provider. You want a business? Ask me. You're all going to laugh, call me crazy from today. It's okay. It's okay. Tell somebody it's okay. I am dreaming big. I'm dreaming of a bank. Somebody's saying, there he goes again. Dream big. Dream for you and your children. How many of you see that credit union as you come on Red Line on the left side? Do you know that credit union is a part of that church that is next to it? I'm not advocating that church. Every church, God expects to have your own riches, your own wealth given to you by God. And that wealth has been put in your hearts. The poverty mentality should break. You have a wealth in you. Finally, I'm going to tell you two important things. Be grateful for the United States of America. From today, I want you to pray against every creeping in of socialism. Socialism will destroy this country. Socialism is evil. I'm telling you right here. Those who understand it, lift your hands and praise God. Socialism is not from God. I told you in the beginning, I said I'll start by telling you ism. Let me talk to you about isms before I come to the final conclusion. Isms. Is legalism good? No. Is legality good? Should you have a legal standard in your life? Yes, but legalism is wrong. Should you be social? Should you give to the poor? Should you give to God's people? Do you see your neighbor struggling? Should you give? Yes, but within the will of God. Any ism is a demon in itself, whether it is legalism, whether it is socialism, whatever it is, that ism is the bad side. Everything is yes and amen in Christ Jesus. This country never had socialism. Did you know? This is the richest country because it gives to God's kingdom, and a lot of people are blessed after they come to the kingdom because they follow this principle. Look at Europe. Look at all the countries in the world. Show me one country which can say that they are well off. And not a single country. Just for information for those of you, most of the countries are right now under Chinese money. Just to let you know. You should know, Jose. Jay. You know what the Chinese do? They lend for 10 years. Come on, take, build your infrastructure. Sri Lanka, come on, man, build your infrastructure. For 10 years, they buy money. After 10 years, interest, please. Interest. No money to give back interest. All right, we will take over your country. Thank you. That is the kind of socialisms. People help with strings attached. That is I-ism. But the kingdom of God, you're wealthy, you give, you thank God. Somebody receive it today. Lord, I thank you because you gave me the ability. It is yours and I am accountable to you. You give me an opportunity to give to somebody. Bless him. Let him also become wealthy. Somebody said hallelujah. You know, pastors, and we speak sometimes about the people we support. I want you to know this. It's your money too. I always look out for pastors. The minute I find that they are corrupt, I immediately tell the pastors, I don't feel comfortable. I have ways of knowing when people are corrupt in financially. I said, hold on, wait, why are they coming? Are they coming to bless you, pastor? I said, hold on. They're coming to bless me? Why don't they go to Myanmar? Why don't they go to Bangladesh? Why don't they go to other places? You know why people want to come to America again and again? You know it. You know the answer. Our pastors have the vision. You don't have to feel sorry for any man of God or me. Do you get an answer? Do you get an amen to that? Never say, Paavam Pastor Shiju, I am not. Don't feel sorry for me. You know, the poor guy has been struggling and he has a wife and two children. So what? That's my business. I'm supposed to be standing here. I'm supposed to look at the challenges. It is my calling. Do I hear an amen? Never sympathize with the man of God. No, I'm teaching you a spiritual principle. Rather pray, Lord, thank you for that guy. Make sure he runs the course well. You strengthen him. You bless him. You provide for him. This is the same principle I do in the church. Because after coming to the United States, I have found so many pastors. When they find somebody is willing to give, no boy, you got a different church here. Can you get the vision? We are willing to support anybody in the world. We have no problem. Whether they are from India, America, Africa, any places. But remember, we don't go by the socialism. We never go by, we go by the principles of God. Just to let you know, before I conclude, I've told some people in the church, if I eat, you will eat. You may be going through the toughest times of your life. I always ask people, many people are so, you know, I can understand that. I've been like that at one time. I asked many people, many of my sisters, and I said, you know, can we help you? Can I help you? I said, no, pastor, it's okay. It's okay. But I want you to know, the wealth of the church belongs to you. In a time of need, it is yours. Do I hear an amen? That is a kind of giving, but it is given to God. That is not socialism. Pray against socialism. Pray against legalism. Pray against isms, and pray that you'll be wealthy by the Lord. In conclusion, I want to tell you something. As we're going to pray, those of you who really heard the message today, and those who really want an anointment for an increase in your life, begin to receive.